songs in the morning. The weeping may endure for a night. So worship Him with all of your might. And now we worship You with all our might. We extol Thee, O God, the Lord Most High. And we magnify You in the earth forever. Oh Lord, You are our God. Holy Father God,
and welcome again to Divine Kingdom Ministries broadcast. I'm so excited that you've joined us again tonight for Intercessors Institute. I'm so excited that you've joined us and that you are gathering together again, and hopefully in front of the computer with your family, with your children, or with your spouse or your loved ones, and you've got your Bible and you've got your notepad and you're ready to dig into the Word of God. As you know, within the last few weeks that we have been doing Intercessors Institute, we have been doing what we call the Principles of Prayer. And we actually started back in November, and I've been kind of taking my time a little bit to go through the principles of prayer, especially when we got to the section of the model in prayer found in Matthew 6. We've been taking our time going through Matthew 6 because I really want to show you how Jesus uses the example of prayer to teach us how to pray. And so tonight, as we continue with the model of prayer, and we go on into verses 12 through the end, we're talking about forgiveness, and we're talking about we're asking God to basically help us daily in the prayer that we're praying. So, of course, before we begin our broadcast tonight, we're going to go ahead and open up in a word of prayer. And I'm going to give you an opportunity once again to go and get your Bible. If you don't have your Bible, call a friend, call a loved one, let them know that we are on the air for the next 30 minutes. Just touching and agreeing, and also just getting into the Word of God about the principles of prayer. I've already discussed with you also when we have started reviewing this section several months back, we're not just talking to intercessors within the Principles of Prayer series. I actually want to reach out to those that also want to develop in their relationship with God. Maybe you are a new believer. Maybe you're somebody that has been saved for a while and you're just kind of trying to get back into prayer, or to get a closer relationship with God, or you had a relationship with God, but you really never connected on a deeper level of understanding what prayer is and how prayer is really just communicating with God and putting yourself in a position not just to talk to God, but that you can actually hear back from God and hear what he has to say. And I love the fact that Jesus already set an example for us in how to pray, found in Matthew 6. And that is what the principles of prayer is all about. We started by talking about in the very beginning, when we started the principles of prayer, how you have to be patient and persistent, how you have to go into prayer already with the mindset and it's the determination is, even if you don't hear immediately, even if you don't get the answer that you are expecting, even if you don't get the answer that you want right away, that you already have a mindset to continue to be persistent, to continue to be patient in prayer. I love scriptures that talk about they that wait upon the Lord, because I don't think those scriptures that just talk about waiting in terms of getting something, but I think those scriptures also apply to waiting before the Lord in prayer, waiting to hear back from him, waiting to hear him speak to you, waiting to hear him talk to you, waiting to hear him respond or hear his heart. Because oftentimes when he doesn't respond immediately, it does not mean that he has not heard you. It means sometimes that he needs to do something in you. Sometimes he just wants you to be patient. So that is where we started in the principles of prayer, just to kind of catch you up a little bit. We also talked about the fact that we have tools when we get into prayer and into intercession. And one of the tools that we have is the Word of God. The Bible talks about the fact that the Word of God is literally a sword. It is called the sword of the Spirit. So when we go into prayer and when we use the Word of God, whether we are praying for ourselves or we're interceding for our families or our ministries, when we go into intercession, when we go into prayer, the tool that we use is the Word of God. That's just one of the tools that we use, but I think it's probably the most important tool that we use when we go into prayer. Some of the other tools that we talked about is how praise and worship is also a tool that you use when you go into prayer. Amen. It is. David used praise as a weapon. I love the statements I've even heard and learned in my studies, that he was not just a warrior. He was a warrior and a worshiper, and he knew how to use the two interchangeably in prayer. Amen. He knew how to worship before God, and he also knew, amen, how to use the Word of God as a tool, as a sword. Amen. Reminding himself of who God was. Amen. And who God is. But also reminding the enemy that he was aware of who God is, using the Word of God against the enemy, just so the enemy even knows you know your word. Don't let the enemy just talk to you. Use the Word of God as your tool, as your sword. Amen. David is a great example of using both worship and using the Word of God. And then a third section of the series that we're going to talk about tonight, as we've been talking about, is the model of prayer. We started back within the last few weeks covering the beginning of the model of prayer, beginning at Our Father, the beginning of course, Our Father who art in heaven, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And I am reading the New International Version. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Amen. And forgive us our debts, as we have forgiven our debtors. That's as far as we got last week. Today, we're going to go a bit further. And we're going to go ahead before we begin and open up in a word of prayer. Amen. Father God, I thank you tonight for those that are once again gathered together with their families and even perhaps even with their friends that are listening, that are tuned in, that are wanting to partake, Father God, tonight of your word. Father God, we love you so much, and we thank you so much for your divine presence and how your spirit rests with us. Hallelujah. Lord God, right where we are, right even where I am, we feel your presence, Lord God, in such a loving, calming, serene way, Father God. And we know, Lord God, that even the time that we spend in your presence is time well spent, Father God. Father God, I thank you, Father God, that you are pleased every time we open your word, every time we listen to something, Lord God, that it can improve us spiritually, every time we make a decision, Father God, that we want to purposely build ourselves up in the spirit, that we want to purposely take time, Father God, to build ourselves in our holy faith up, to give ourselves spiritual bread and spiritual food that we can grow. Father God, I know you're pleased every single time we take the time, Father God, to go before before you. Every time, Father God, we take the time to open our hearts and open our ears and open our mind to learn more. Father God, you love us so much. You love us so much, Father God. Oh God, that you would go to the ends of the earth to teach us of your word. So tonight, God, those that are listening, I pray a special prayer over them, a special anointing in the name of Jesus. I rebuke the enemy from them in Christ Jesus' name, the cares and the stresses of the world, the cares and the stresses of the day. I rebuke from them even right now, God, in the name of Jesus. And I decree complete rest, to complete calmness, complete peace to come upon them in the name of Jesus, Father God. I intercede for them, Father God, that whatever miracle they need, whatever financial breakthrough they need, whatever circumstance that they need you to work out, my God, that you would begin right now to turn it around in the name of Jesus. I rebuke the enemy in Christ Jesus' name. He has no place. He has no authority. You have given us authority, Father God, over the enemy. Hallelujah. And tonight we command him, hallelujah, to get underneath our feet. We command him to get even underneath your very feet. Hallelujah. You have power and authority over the enemy in Christ Jesus' name. And I just speak that tonight, even wherever you are, over whatever circumstance you may be going through, Father God. I thank you that you are giving them peace. You're giving them the understanding that they have overcome the enemy in every single area of their life. In Christ Jesus' name, let them begin tonight to know how much authority they have in you and that they walk daily in that authority. Hallelujah. Not being defeated, not walking in defeat, but having an overcomer's attitude. In Christ Jesus' name, I pray. Hallelujah. Bless them tonight as they listen to this broadcast. In Christ Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I hope you've had an opportunity to get your Bibles. And in case you haven't, I'm going to go ahead and just put the Lord's Prayer up here for you, just so you can have a point of reference if you haven't had a chance to actually get a Bible, or maybe you're in a position where you can't get to a Bible right now. That's okay. Hallelujah. Let's just take a quick review. Let's start at the beginning. Our Father which art in heaven, this is what we have covered in the last few weeks. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. And we won't get into that tonight because we've discussed that within the last few weeks. And if you have not had a chance to listen to those broadcasts, those are available on ustream.com. And I want you to go back and get those and just kind of catch yourself up to each section of that prayer and how each section of that prayer means something and how each section of that prayer is relevant. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And that was what we covered last week. Amen. And forgive us our trespasses or our debts or our sins. Depends upon which version you're reading from. As we forgive those that trespass against us. I will just quickly comment on that. One of the things that we talked about even last week, even as we were coming in to what we're about to discuss this week, is the importance of forgiveness and how forgiveness is not necessarily just for that person, but the forgiveness is for you. And understanding the concept, even we have a series coming up at the end of this month called Forgiving to Be Forgiven, because the forgiving with a G, to be forgiven with an N. And the reason why we're titling it that, because there's a scripture in the Bible that lets us know that even if we don't forgive others their sin, our Heavenly Father can't forgive us. And that's scriptural. But understanding how powerful the principle of forgiveness is, because our sins had to be forgiven. Amen. Our sins and the precious blood of Jesus washed away your sins just as well as he washed away your neighbor's sin. So we have to practice that principle of forgiving and understanding that it even if the person you feel deserves it, even if you feel the person is a person that does not deserve the forgiveness of God, I want you to think about whether or not we deserve the forgiveness of God. But still, he sent his son Jesus to die. You may say, Elder Victoria, you don't know what they did. You don't know how they hurt me. Were you crucified? And this is not to discount your pain, not even a little bit. but to understand. The Bible says in all ways he was tempted as we were, yet without sin. And talking about Jesus, that means Jesus was hurt, Jesus was betrayed. There is nothing that you have felt, there is nothing, no betrayal, no feeling, no insecurity, nothing that has ever happened to you or ever occurred in your life, amen, that first of all, that Jesus was not aware of, or even that Jesus had not felt in some type of way while he walked this earth. So he understands, but yet he says it's important that you forgive. When you forgive, we even talked about that last week, it's like unknotting or untying a hose. And when you untie a hose, if you think about the hose that you used to wash your car with in the backyard, when you unknot or untie that hose, it gives you a free channel, amen, for water to flow through, a free tube or connection for water to flow through. And it's the same thing with unforgiveness. When you forgive and you untie that knot, so that the blessings of God can flow through, so that the freedom of God, so that liberty, when you begin, if you talk to someone that has ever really been knotted up by unforgiveness, and then they make a decision, because it is a decision, it starts here. It doesn't start here, it starts here. It starts with you saying, I choose to forgive. And when you choose to forgive, then your heart, your emotions, your the physical part of your body begins to respond to the decision that you made here. So forgiveness starts with your decision. So the word of God says, and forgive them their trespasses, as we're talking about the Lord's Prayer. Amen. Forgive them their trespasses. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass us, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. Now let's go a little bit further as we are concluding this part, this section, the Lord's Prayer section of the principles of prayer. And lead us not into temptation. God's desire is never for you to go into sin. God never tempts anyone. There's a scripture in the Bible that says, let no man say I am tempted of God. Yes, temptations come your way. Struggles may come your way every single day. Sometimes even the word says that we're tempted out of our own flesh, and sometimes the enemy does bring temptations our way. But the Bible says, lead us not into temptation. It is a prayer of saying, God, don't lead me into areas of temptation. Now, in the Bible, there was a place in which Jesus had to go into the wilderness to be tempted, because he did that for us. He did that to set a precedent or an example of being able to overcome temptation. And we talked about that earlier, of how every single time the enemy came against him in those areas of temptation, he responded with our tool, which was what? He responded with the word of God. But the scripture that we're focusing on tonight, it says, and Lord, lead us not into temptation. Don't take us into to areas of temptation. Don't take me into areas, dear Lord, where I'm going to be weak, but deliver us from evil. This is the Lord's example to us in prayer. This is the way that we pray when we go before the Father in the beginning of the day, when we are beginning of our day, before we go to work or go to school or whatever it is that you do throughout the course of your day, or if you're a housewife, before you begin your chores, beginning in the morning in prayer and saying, Lord, hallelujah, do not lead me into temptation. Don't allow me to be led into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver me from the evil that the enemy may want to bring my way. Amen. The strategies, the traps, the plots. A lot of times that's the way I pray. You pray proactively. You don't wait for things to come. Amen. But the Holy Spirit will give you discernment. He will give you a clear understanding if you pray. Amen. And this is why it's important to get those principles of prayer in your heart. Amen. And have a relationship with God that is so sure and so secure, because the Lord, the Holy Spirit, will tell you in advance what the enemy is going to do. The Holy Spirit will let you know, listen, this is the way I need you to pray. Listen. Begin to develop that relationship in your ear to hear the voice of God, because it will save you. Begin to hear, inclining your ear, training your ear to understand the voice of God. I remember, and I ended up learning this lesson even myself several years ago, the hard way, because the Lord was trying to teach me how to hear and how to respond to and obey His voice. And now this was several years ago that the Lord was telling me. It was on one particular day that I woke up, and it was just something was wrong. I don't know what was wrong, and I found out later. But it was, stay home today. You know, don't go out. Just stay home today and pray. And I'm like, no, I got to go. You know, I got stuff to do. I got places to go, et cetera, et cetera. And so I ignored that voice, not really understanding the severity of what was going to happen that day. Went out, was on my way to work, and got in a car accident. Was not even paying attention. Car was totaled. Later, I began to understand the Holy Spirit was letting me know, you need to have listened to what I had said. You should have spent that time in prayer. You should have spent time listening and obeying the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit will teach you. He will help you to avoid. Many times the Holy Spirit even now will speak and say, hey, don't go in that direction. And because I learned the hard way, because I learned His voice, I now respond. And what I'm saying to you is, and I've seen, even as I respond, what I've been able to avoid traps, or if something has occurred, the Holy Spirit, because I prayed in advance, had an answer there for me immediately, or I was prepared. So when you begin to listen and learn the voice of the Lord, you can pray in advance, amen, to avoid the strategies and the plots of the enemy. You can pray in advance to be brought and delivered from evil, because the Holy Spirit will reveal things to you. The Bible talks about He is a revealer of truth, amen. He reveals the will of the Father. And so when we are praying the way Jesus has called us to pray, we pray with understanding, and we pray with revelation knowledge from who? From the Spirit of God. And we're saying, Lord, deliver us from evil. Don't let us enter into temptation. Even Jesus Himself, in His prayer, in His model prayer, Jesus Himself said these things. And what more, even as us as intercessors, us as believers, needing to follow in His example of prayer, of strategic prayer, of using the Word of God. Even those intercessors that tune in frequently on the Intercessors Institute part, those that join on the prayer line. You know, one of the books that I use, one of the tools that we use, is a book called The Prayer Book, The Red Book, The Prayer Book. And those that even want to get some more information about that, please contact me, and I'll let you know a little bit more about that, and also how to become a part of just the intercessors part of Intercessory Institute. But one of the reasons that I love this book is because it has within it scriptures. It has prayers, but it has scriptures that are connected to different prayers and different things. And because every time we pray, we have to pray strategically. We have to know what the Word of God says. Amen. And so when we're talking about avoiding temptation, when we're talking about being delivered from evil, when we're talking about strategically praying to avoid the plots and the plans of the enemy, because make no mistake, God has a plan for your life, but the enemy also has a plan, and his plan is to trap you. But, amen, God has already made a way for you, and made ways of escape for you, and provided solutions and answers for you. I got to say that again. He's already made a way for you. He's already provided solutions and answers for you. Amen. The way is already made. All God is saying is, talk to me, listen to me, hear my voice, heed my warnings. Many times as parents, we give our children warnings. We give them correction. We give them guidance. And when they listen, they're able to avoid the temptations. They're able to avoid the traps and avoid the evil that may be awaiting them. And it's the same thing. God wants to have that same type of relationship, just like a parent would have with a child. God wants to have that same type of relationship with you, where you can talk to Him and He can speak back to you, and you can incline your ear and really listen and hear what He has to say and avoid the traps that the enemy may have. Amen. And that's what it's all about, because God loves us. He does not plan for you your destruction. He never plans for you destruction. The Bible says that the thoughts that He thinks towards you are good thoughts Amen. He wants to prosper you and bring you hope in a future is what the word of God says. And so because of that, all he wants you to do is incline your ear. Get a download from him. Get the insight from him of what his plans are for your life for today. Get an understanding of what he's saying for you from the beginning. Amen. Get the instructions from the master instructor giver. Get the instructions from the master teacher. Amen. Get the instructions from the sergeant in command, from the general himself. Get the instructions from the ones that already knows the game plan. You know, maybe you are a person that is into sports or football or basketball. Who do you get the instructions from? You get the instructions from the coach because he already knows the strategies of the game. He already knows the game plan. Amen. God is your coach. Go to him. Get the instructions. Find out what he is saying for you for your day. Amen. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine, as we continue, for thine is the kingdom. I love how this prayer is ended in worship. It is ended in worship. Amen. For thine is the kingdom. Whose is the kingdom? We're now talking to God. Amen. We're already beginning this prayer in communication with God. And on the intercessors, I want to interject something to you too. The model of the Lord's Prayer is for those that are praying for themselves, but also for intercessors, because as intercessors, we even align our prayers up with the Lord's Prayer. From praying and worshiping in the beginning to understanding positionally who God is and that his kingdom reigns, his kingdom has come, amen, and the authority that have. And when we go in and we're asking on the behalf of someone else and we're asking God to help them avoid temptation and to help them avoid evil and we're praying the word of God, we always end, even as we're praying for others in intercession, in worship. Amen. Because we don't pray just to pray. We pray believing and knowing that our Father hears us. We pray understanding that every single time we open our mouths to pray, my Father already knows what I'm going to say. And he already has provided an answer and a solution. Amen. To my prayer. So they end in worship. For thine is the kingdom. God, yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Worship is so important. It is so important. It is such a vital tool in beginning your prayer and ending your prayer, because worship shapes the heart. It waters the garden of your heart. So many times we sing songs without hearing the message. And sometimes we just sing songs because they sound good and we like the beat and we may like the bass line and we like the, may like the rhythm and all of those kinds of things. And so, you know, and I like listening to Christian music too, that may have a bass line or may have a beat or may have a nice hook, etc. But it's the message. It's the heart of the message. It's the heart of getting into a place of worship. Hear me. Worship. It's not just the singing. It's not just the actions. It's hearing. It's worship that shapes our heart. It's worship that creates a foundation here. This is what's important, that creates a foundation in which the word of God can be implanted. Amen. Just like a garden that's being watered and the ground become made soft before the seed goes into the ground. I want you to get a visual image in your mind of a garden. Or somebody that's maybe planting a seed of some sort or a farm, and they're preparing the land before the seed is put into the ground and softening and getting the soil just right. Amen. Getting the moisture level just right, or whatever needs to be done in the ground just right. Amen. Those things are so, worship does just that. It prepares the ground of our heart. It prepares the ground of our heart so that when we hear the word of God, it becomes implanted in good ground in our heart and in good ground in our spirit. Amen. It's so important. It is so important to have a relationship with God that allows you to be a worshiper, in a sense that you can worship the Father and he can change your heart. You can worship the Father and he can massage and work in your spirit. Amen. You can worship the Father and he can download something into you. You can worship the Father and he can give you seeds of righteousness. I love the exchange of when we give, we get back. Amen. Hallelujah. And so as we have reviewed the entire Lord's Prayer, we're going to all put it together now. And next week when we come back and revisit the Lord's Prayer before we go into the next section, we're going to do a review of each section of the Lord's Prayer. And as I stated at the beginning, next week is also the time that if those of you that if you were here from the beginning and I asked you to submit your prayer requests and those kind of things, and I asked you to begin to pray even according to these models, you have maybe praise reports. This is the time to begin to submit those this week, and we'll discuss them more. If you want to just kind of just give God a shout out on within our broadcast, and testimony, if you want to send us a written testimony that you'd like us to read out loud on the broadcast, we can do that as well. But the important thing is understanding how the Lord has modeled a prayer for us as an example, whether we are doing intercession or whether we are praying for ourselves. And so as we continue this series on the principles of prayer, we are going to revisit that section next week, the Lord's Prayer as a model of prayer. And then the following week, we're going to talk about a few more things, a few more important parts of having principles in prayer, of the principles in prayer. Amen. And we're just going to even give the Holy Spirit just an opportunity to move how he wants to, because I don't want to rush. I don't want to go and finish this series too quickly. And one of the things that the Lord has said to me in giving you an opportunity to put those principles to work, once that happens, we're going to see how the Holy Spirit is going to even direct the ending of the Principles of Prayer series as we go into forgiving to be forgiven within the next few weeks, actually starting on the 31st of this month. Also, those of you in the Durham, North Carolina surrounding areas that are intercessors and want more information on linking up with me and Divine Kingdom Ministries on Intercessory Institute and Intercessors Institute, please contact us at our website, www.dkmparachurchministry.org. I'm going to be giving you some information in the next few weeks about some upcoming, wonderful upcoming things that is going to be happening in the Durham, North Carolina area within the next few months. And especially for the intercessors in the month of July. If you are on our Facebook page, I've advertised it there. The intercessors prayer conference, amen, that we our ministry always participates in, and I'll give you more information about that in the next few weeks, but just continue to stay tuned. And it's just, like I said, it's a lot of exciting things that are coming up and that are about to happen, like I said, within the next few months and within the next few months even headed into the summer. So until then, contact us, www.dkmparachurchministry.org. send us your testimonies, and I can't wait to hear what God is doing, and I can't wait really to see how he's going to direct the end of this series, because the principles in prayer is very important for us to have a relationship with God and continuing developing and growing in our relationship with God. God bless you until I see you again next week, same time.
The Bible says in Psalms 145:2, every day I will bless you and I will praise